Morning. Skinning my knees, and I was always muddy. I used to lay there at night with my sister, and we'd giggle and laugh. But Mama said Daddy was gonna get mad, so we invented our own. On each other's backs, and we would, you know, share secrets like sisters do. Sometimes we'd lay there at night in the sweet grass looking up at the stars, and we really wondered if there was a man on the moon. I really miss those days. One of my favorite games was playing hide and seek, but not this kind of hide and seek. Now it's kind of like I have to hide every single day and be on the alert. This big old creepy grain mill was out in the middle of nowhere. I mean, I might be running out of supplies soon, and I might have to abandon it soon, but I'll have to wait till nighttime and travel then. Haven't seen much of anybody, but there is a train that goes by. I can hear it in the distance, and it passed some tracks on the way. So, makes me wonder what's going on. Well, I haven't been doing much about investigating this creepy old place. It's really wet in here. I'm thinking it's a rattlesnake or bugs or something. Probably rats. Anyway, I'm by myself still. Missing my sister Grace. God bless her little soul. I really wish that she would find me. I'm thinking that she will. She's a tough little thing, and we're so close. It's almost like I can read her mind, even though I'm clinging across the country. Well, I guess I'll make to myself some more Joe and roll me a cigarette and put out this fire before anybody sees it. So far I'm alone. I'm playing hide and seek, I know, but it's a different kind of hide and seek. And I don't want to get found. Last night, Footsteps in the gravel. Footsteps getting closer and closer. And a strange buzzing sound. And what sounded to me like a pair of wings flapping really loud. The noises became closer, as if someone something was right inside of this creepy old place. I hurried up and hid inside one of my little hiding places, and I could hear a loud thumping noise in my ears when I realized it was my own heart beating like crazy. The noises became more and more distant, and then silent. So to say that my head aches and my back hurts, that would be like the understatement of the year. I waited for a bit and then slowly crawled out of the shadows, my rucksack with no Suddenly, the vision of those train tracks popped into my head. They're a ways down a bit, miles and miles away. But the hell with it, I thought. I have to get out of here. Lucky for me, there was a beautiful full moon. And that moon was my friend. Because it lit up the landscape. Just enough that I could see where I was heading. After walking a little ways, I began to hear what I thought was running water. And the more I walked, the louder the sounds became. Until finally I could smell it. A stream. I saw this as some kind of divine intervention. I whispered under my breath, how in the heck did a stream get out here in the middle of nowhere? I relished this moment and decided to rest for a spell. I sat beneath the stand of tall trees. I sat down on the cool dark earth and looked up towards the heavens. Those stars were so close I felt like I could just reach up and snatch one right out of the sky. I rolled me a cigarette and inhaled deeply. Wow, how in the hell did I end up in this place? What a A million things run through your mind when you've been alone as long as I have. I felt something crawling on my arm, and when I flicked my lighter to see what it was, there sat a ladybug. I instantly thought of my mama. You see, she loved ladybugs, and throughout my life, whenever I am in such a situation, a ladybug will appear. I felt like this is a sign from her, telling me to hang in there, that things will be just fine. Call me crazy, but it's the truth. I remember talking to my mama when I was a young gal. I told her there was no way up stuck in that town, barefoot and pregnant like my sisters and all my friends. My daddy was such a son of a bitch and ruled our house with an iron fist. My sisters and I grew up in fear of him. By God, the entire town knew what a mean son. did have his good qualities. I always helped people in need. He always worked hard to feed us kids, and when I was 2 years of age, I stopped breathing in my sleep, and my daddy breathed. Best not to cry, but it didn't work. I kissed the salty tears on her cheek, and I told her, "I'll be back, Mama." She dabbed at her eyes with one of her hankies and shoved it into my shirt pocket. When I drove away, I couldn't bear to look back. I just could not. So I left my 300 miles down the highway, I stopped to get some gas and something to eat. I pulled my mom's hanky from my pocket, and tucked inside was $300. That night, I could smell Mama's perfume on that hanky. It smelled like Dune, her favorite perfume. I climbed in. Because that was my mama. She always took really good care of me. At daybreak, I was back on the road and headed out west. I thought, shoot, maybe I'll go to Hollywood like everyone else does. Maybe I'll be in the movies. Maybe I'll get a good job. I'll be in California and everything is gonna be peachy keen. Before long, that big city felt like it was gonna swallow me up alive. So I moved as far away as I could. Took a country road out to the middle of nowhere. Started a new life. And things were good for a while. Until all hell broke loose. Things pop into your head when you least expect them to. I stood up and stretched and grabbed my rucksack, headed back into the darkness. I listened to the running water and followed that stream until the sun came up. And when it did, I'd finally reached the train tracks. And let me tell you, sunrise was the most beautiful I'd ever seen. As I rounded the bend, I stood frozen in awe. There before me was a beautiful green mountain range. It felt as if I were in a dream, because the place was just like what I imagined an oasis to look like. It was like something straight out of a picture book. I could hear the birds chirping, an eagle flapping his wings. I even spotted a deer. A ways in the distance, I spotted a small white dot. I headed through the woods and got closer and closer until I came upon a little white cottage. It was nestled in the valley all by itself. As I approached, I pulled my gun from its holster and cocked it. I figured with clothes still hanging on the clothesline, someone had to be inside. I knocked quietly, ready to take something out if it so much as said boo. But the door swung open with a creak and I stepped inside. Toys and toys were scattered on the floor. push any negative thoughts from my head. Chill ran up my spine when I realized that someone or something had run this family off. So here I sit. Guess I'll go through my rucksack to see what the damages are. Flashlight. I have an extra pair of boots. And of course I have my mama's hanky. And it still smells. I think this place will do just fine. It's hidden. Well, it's hidden enough. So I guess I'll stay a while. Catch you on the flip side. Another sleepless night. I've been on pins and needles, you know. Like I'm being watched by someone or something. For weeks, I've had repeated dreams of a young woman. She's dressed in white and appears to be lost. Chase after the woman, and when I confront her, she disappears. Man, I wish these nightmares would disappear with her. Better grab me some coffee and start at the beginning. I am hearing things at night. Not wild animals like coyotes or bear, but creaking floorboards, footsteps. It's as if someone is walking around my place. Things have moved by themselves. A face here, a picture frame there. Last week, I ran across a carving trunk of the weeping willow that sits next to my front porch. Eileen was here, 1855. Strange how I never noticed it before. This morning, I was at the creek and spied a scrap dangling from the branch of an old fir tree. When I returned, I stumbled across three books that had fallen from a high shelf. They are aged and tattered, noticed them before. Strange. I haven't touched the books until now. I wanted to. Well, I guess now is as good a time as any. Viacito Station. The second is a diary. Eileen O'Connor. And the third is a complete ruin, save for one page that states, the Butterfield stage. Guess I'll start with the first one. Diary of Miss Eileen O'Connor. May 1st, 1855. Today I learned that my beloved has struck it rich in the California gold mines. I am to join him shortly. He has paid my $200 fare. Leaving my family home in Missouri will be bittersweet. I am excited at the prospect of becoming his bride, and my dress is finally finished. It is beautiful white silk with lace trim, which I meticulously sewed myself. I am the happiest woman. May 3rd, 1855. We left this morning at first daylight. I was told by the driver that it would take nearly 28 days to travel 150 miles from here to Yuma. The coach itself is comfortable enough, and my bags are safely stowed above. The sky is a brilliant blue, and there is not a cloud in sight. I feel giddy with excitement, like a young schoolgirl off on a big adventure. I can hardly wait to arrive at Viacito Station in California. May 18th, 1855. The days are It seems the further west we travel, the hotter it becomes. In fact, the heat is nearly unbearable. Thank goodness the horses and mules are made to rest every 10 miles or so. Our driver told me we are halfway to Viacito. I am patiently counting the days, the minutes, the hours, as I listen to the endless creaking of the wooden wheels of the stage. I have not been sleeping well. I am tired. May 31st, 1855. I have not felt like myself as of late. I have noticed that my dresses no longer suit. They are three sizes too large. I tell myself that the stifling heat is the culprit. We have confronted a lot of turbulence along the way. Choking dust, sudden cloud bursts, and blustering winds. They come and go as they please. We are now, and always have been, the mercy of the elements. Each bump in the road is knocking the wind from me and making my bones ache. some stop along the way has made me weak and dizzy. I can see the Fiesito station in the distance, but I am too sick and tired to even care. I fear something has surely this diary belonged to the same woman who carved her name on that old tree, sitting right outside of my front door. Interesting, and yeah, more than a little spooky for my taste. Let's see what this Fiesito Station book says. Maybe it will shed some light. Fiesito Station, Sarah Lassiter, June 8th, 1855. On this day, we laid to rest the beautiful Miss Eileen O'Connor of Missouri. We tried our best to nurse her back to health, but all was for naught. She went to be with her maker. Good Lord bless her soul. Hold on just a minute. There's one more entry from the woman who owned Fiesito Station. Sarah Lassiter, June 10th, 1855. Ever since we buried Eileen O'Connor, strange things have been happening. Our drivers and horses have been spooked. Our passengers are scared half to death. On moonlit nights, a woman dressed in white paces restlessly in front of the station. She furtively glances to the east, waiting for the next stagecoach to take her to her own true love. Wait a minute. There's a faint map drawn inside of the Butterfield stage book. Looks like a burial site on the grounds of Fiesito Station. Campo Santo, a cemetery. This here's a map with an X marking the spot where Eileen O'Connor is buried in an unmarked. Seems like I have a decision to make. Lucky for me, I know this country like the back of my hand. I am situated between the fringe, lush valley, and harsh desert, not too far from Fiesito. It's going to be risky, but it sounds to me like I need to find that grave and give Miss O'Connor stone. Maybe then she'll rest in peace. So, guess I'll pack up my gear and be on my way, trying to time it just right. The question is,